So Spirit, come, breath of God, disperse the shadows over us, renew and strengthen your people.
And also with you. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, by whose hand we are given new birth, by whose speaking we are given new life.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are welcomed, restored, and supported as citizens of the new creation. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Holy God, holy and merciful, holy and mighty, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. In mercy and might, you have freed us from death and raised us with Jesus, the firstborn of the dead. In baptismal waters, our old life is washed away, and in them we are born anew. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for waters that wash us clean, quench our thirst, and nurture both crops and creatures. Praise to you for the life-giving water of baptism, the outpouring of the Spirit of the new creation. Satisfy the world's needs through this living water. Where drought dries the earth, bring refreshment. Where despair prevails, grant hope. Where chaos reigns, bring peace. We ask this through Christ, who with you and the Spirit reigns forever.
Thank you. O God, on this day you open the hearts of your faithful people by sending into us your Holy Spirit. Direct us by the light of that Spirit, that we may have a right judgment in all things and rejoice at all times in your peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Elamites in Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus in Asia, Phyra, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews, proselytes, Cretans, and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit, and I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious name. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
yonder is the sea, great and wide. There go the ships.
And the lie of them that you formed to sport in it.
They all look to you.
To give them their food in due season.
When you give to them, they gather it up.
When you open your hand, they are filled with good things.
When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you send forth your spirit, they are created.
And you renew the face of the ground.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
May the Lord rejoice in God's works.
Who looks on the earth and it trembles.
Who touches the mountains and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live.
I will sing praise to my God while I live.
May my meditation be pleasing to God. Bless the Lord, O my soul. From the first letter to the church in Corinth. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever said, "Let Jesus be cursed." And no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given the Spirit of utterance, the utterance of wisdom, and to another, the utterance of knowledge. According to the same Spirit, to another, faith by the same Spirit, to another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another, the working of miracles, to another, prophecy, to another, the discernment of spirits, to another, various kinds of tongues, to another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples have met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you." As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Fasted this morning, wearing all red, and for those who don't, we are have some red in our body here today. It's a Pentecost Sunday, so happy birthday to church. Around 2,000 years ago, the early disciples gathered together.
They have probably no idea that 2,000 years later, here we are, we'll be wearing red, and we'll be celebrating the birthday of church. So they gathered, the disciples gathered as Jesus promised them that the advocate would come. So they gathered in where? Jerusalem. And they waited for the Spirit, and as they prayed and as they devoted themselves, remembering Christ and remembering the stories, and as they devoted themselves in their faith, what happened? The wind blew in and the Spirit of God descended upon them like flames. And we've seen all these paintings in the past centuries, this fire, right? This morning, someone came up to me and asked me, "Can you make a connection between why we are wearing red and Pentecost?" Well, we're wearing red because it's the color of what? Fire, that's right. And we've seen paintings and drawings of fire on top of people's head, right? For Pentecost. And that's what it is. It's about imagery of trying to tell story of how God's Spirit came and descended upon the early disciples. Now, these disciples of Jesus, they, you know, if you really look at them and their social standing and their status, they were a bunch of people that really didn't stood out. You know, they were kind of invisible. They were Galileans, as the scripture says. They're from the north, from the way up, where it was very insignificant to the empire of Rome. But there they were in Jerusalem, in the center of this city, where the hub of the center of Judea, where their worshiping temple is there, where diaspora, you know, there was many Jews from different parts of the regions of the empire that day to celebrate Pentecost have gathered to celebrate this holiday. And there they were, the Galileans. They were experiencing the outpouring of the Spirit of God. And then they began to do what? They speak in tongues, right? Now, some of you may have gone to Pentecostal churches or have experienced in a very more conservative or evangelical churches where people actually, what they call, what I would call a pre-language kind of expressions, you know, not lightly put, right? But people actually spoke in tongues, right? Now, maybe that experience is transforming for those individuals. They may validate their experience, and that's fine. But what is then really the miracle of Pentecost? What happened here in this text? When you read this text carefully, as we read Acts chapter 2 every Pentecost Sundays, when you pay careful attention, the miracle of Pentecost is that when people are gathered, it's not so much of speaking, but how is it that these Galileans are speaking, but we each hear from different parts of the region that we have gathered from, right? How is it that we, each of us, hear in our own what? Language. How is it possible that I'm able to understand what they were saying? The miracle of Pentecost is hearing, listening, if you pay careful attention. So here are these disciples, marginalized folks, insignificant, invisible. They have voice. There's another miracle, right? They are given voice. They are able to express themselves of what God's experience is like for them, how transforming it is, how they are together, belonging to each other, to bear witness of this good news, the message. They are commissioned by God, right? Empowered by God. That's how our church starts. The birth of church starts with the empowerment of the Spirit of God. And there they were. They're given voice. They're given visibility. And the miracle happens. All of a sudden, people from all over the world or in that empire gathered, and they're able to hear for the first time what they are actually saying. So what are they hearing, actually? Do you have any idea? What are they praying? What are they saying? Peter got up. Some people were saying, all right, these people must be drunk, right? That's one thing somebody said, right? They're drunk. And Peter got up and said, I love this passage where he gets up and he says, no, do not suppose that they're drunk here. They're not drunk. It's only 9 in the morning. I love how he specifies time, right? You rarely see that, but he says, it's only 9 in the morning. Drunkenness happens late at night. These folks are not drunk, but they are possessed by the Spirit of God. I guess that's what it feels like when you are intoxicated, but you are intoxicated by the Spirit of God. That is what there is happening there, right? So he gets up and he tells a story of the prophet Joel, who says, look, in that end time, when that day comes, young men and women will see visions and will prophesy. And old men and old women will dream dreams. So what are these visions and prophecies and dreams? What is all that, if not the longing of people for a better life, perhaps, to exercise freedom that God has given to be fully alive as a human being, right? And what does that look like? To live in that kind of a freedom, to live in a place where people actually belong and care for each other other than the kingdom of God that says God loves you and you belong and you are beloved by God, right? This vision that these folks had, prophecy, dreams, when they are situated in an empire oppressive system by which they are suffering under, there they are. In that last day, young men and women will see visions when there are no visions anymore. Sometimes we look around in our society, in our communities, and be like, when is this going to be over? Where's the vision? How can our church here today prophesy? And our old men and women, just as God brought Moses out of his retirement and sent him to Egypt to liberate freedom for enslaved people. Some of us need to get out of our retirement. Maybe God is calling you, right? Dream dreams. So there they are. Church. It's the birth of the church. In that last day when it seems like there's no more vision, how are we as a church to prophesy? What does a prophesy mean? To have vision, to have hope. You know, our politics in our country is so conflicted, right? Those who are supposed to represent us, to be our voice, are not representing us. We continue to have gun violence when vast majority of the people have common sense and says, here's a common regulation, laws that we could implement to ensure some safety, right? Simple as that. But it seems like it's going nowhere. As an example, we look around. Ukraine war, what's going on in Sudan, so many parts of the world. We have not learned from our history. So every generation, we are called to have vision, to prophesy, to dream dreams. None of us are exempt here. Young and old, we are all to be included. And in that last day, Peter gets up and says what? The Spirit, the same Spirit of God will be poured upon you. Jews, Greeks, Gentiles, doesn't matter, woman, child, what else? Slave, free. Unfortunately, that was a part of their culture. What else? That is very inclusive, is not? Pentecost experience is very inclusive because the Spirit of God is very inclusive. It doesn't discriminate. Not only just human beings, but we had liturgy today from Psalms. What did it say? From creation, the Spirit of God is already there. It's the outpouring of the Spirit, that's life itself, is poured upon this particular people to give them visibility, voice, hope, vision, prophecy, and what? Dreams. It's an inclusive experience. A Galilean, a particular community from Galilee, came and spoke, given visibility, and the inclusion of multi-languages and able to hear in their own language is the miracle of Pentecost. This morning, before the worship began, I did a little history search. I walked into our library today and looked at the covenant members. Did you ever look at that paper? That is as prominently on the wall when you walk into the library. It's part of our history here. Go check out the names over there. There are a lot of people there. Covenant members, in other words, the founding members of the church. There must be at least 200 plus there, or three. There are a lot of people on the list. Some of you are on the list. I looked at it and goes, wow. When this church was organized and the presbytery bought a piece of property out here, back then, that was what, almost 45, 48 years ago? This area was what? It was nothing like it is today. When I got here, I hear conversations from you all, and you're telling me, oh, I remember those days when Custer Road had only one lane going that way and one lane going this way. Now there are two lanes going this way and two lanes going that way. There was no Kroger there. This was like a farm field out there. Dusty road, maybe a convenience store one and there, like 3 miles apart. Remember those old pictures when you look at the founding of this church when it was constructed? Out there was like horizon. There was like emptiness. When this church began, some of you may remember that, right? Yeah. And there were only like maybe in Plano 30,000 people. I know what that little town looks like, actually. I was an interim pastor at where? Cleburne. It probably felt like Cleburne. It's a small city, small town. Coming from Los Angeles and New York, it really looks small. Where the population is 8, 10, 12 million. The largest city, New York City and LA. And when God called and said, you need to go to Texas. Texas where? Cleburne. I did a research. Oh, goodness. Cleburne. The Confederate General. Okay. Maybe God was telling me or teaching me a little lesson about Plano prior to coming here and wanted me to experience in time, travel time back 40 years ago. Maybe that was the case. But think for a moment. Some of you who remember, I remember photos like there were just, we had two services here, early morning and a little later morning, right? It was packed. Some of you remember that. We had a huge youth group, activities. And we feel like, okay, we remember the birth of the church. The Presbytery organized and sent Reverend, what is it, Eunice Burnett, right, was the organizing pastor. Maurice. Yes, Burnett. And then you had, I believe, Rebecca. Okay, see, some of you remember. Yeah, you were there. The organizing clergy members. And this church was full house. The church began in 1974, met at small houses. Small gatherings, and a year later they met at Davis Elementary School. And some of you may remember the cafeteria where you worship. You remember that? You remember that? There is a Pentecost there. And there you were, praising God, reading the Psalms. And when this church was built in 1978, I believe it was completed, and you all came in here, these are the original chairs that were still there. There's something about this congregation that really drew me here. You know what it was? That from the beginning, you were open to do a very experimental worship. When back then, every pews in the Presbyterian church were bolted down, you wanted some movable chairs so you could have much more fluid worship service. And you remember that. I remember when I was being interviewed by the pastoral search committee, they said, our churches, our seats are movable. And I said, wow, that's amazing. It's the attitude, it's the posture of the congregation, the openness to experimenting with new worship style and all kinds of liturgy that could be possible when you have a movable pews. So you remember that. So what does this Pentecost 2,000 years ago, the birth of the church, have to do with our history? When the church began in a small town, Plano, at the time, when the covenant members gathered and they worshiped, yes, they had vision. They had vision that this congregation will grow and prosper and will bear witness to the gospel which they have committed, the outpouring of the Spirit, the baptismal covenant that poured out, and we are united as body of Christ, as the Corinthians, letter of Corinth, have articulated. We are one body poured out by the Spirit of God, united in that Spirit. And when the early founding members of the church here, I know some of you are founding members of this church, had a vision. The presbytery had vision. It was a collective effort and understood that. But do they also knew that decades later, you will have a Korean-American pastor showing up here? Do they know that the demographics, this place, Plano, will be 300,000 people with international companies all over this area and bring Indians, Koreans, Japanese, and many different ethnic folks all the way from halfway around the world here living here, and how diverse this community has become since? God has called these folks all from all over, not just the Roman Empire, but from where? All over the world. Pentecost, that started in 1974, is continuing. The Pentecost that started 2,000 years ago is continuing. We could never imagine even tomorrow what's going to happen. But here we are, years, decades later, we're still experiencing the Pentecost. There is a reawakening going on. The Pentecost is not over yet. It is a community of inclusion. It is about vision. It's about prophecy. It is about dreaming dreams. So here we are today, 2023, Pentecost. What is our vision? What is our prophecy? What do you dream? What dream do you have? Everyone is included, no exception. What is our Pentecost experience? How are those who are gathered in our community are going to say, hey, oh my God, we are hearing it in our own language. Language is not just simply this. How is it that I, from such a different places, able to connect with this community? What is going on here that I am able to make connection, that I'm able to understand, that they understand me? As we are moved by the Spirit of God's inclusion, there's a lot of work to be done. There's a lot of challenges ahead in the future, today and tomorrow. It's not over. God is not done with us yet, in other words. God is shaping us, renewing us with the Spirit of God. And we look around now today, after 4 decades later, and you look at the membership list of all the covenant members and say, 80% are all gone. Where are they? We wish those good old days were here today. We look around. What is our dream? What is our vision? What is our prophecy today? We look at empty pews and we feel a little smaller. And we feel the community has grown large. And we feel smaller and smaller and smaller. And the scripture says, in that last day, you will prophesy. The disciples in our gospel reading today gathered and huddled together in fear. because the world they know outside of that door has changed significantly. They feel threatened. They feel small. Whatever happened to that Jesus movement where thousands have gathered with two fish and five loaves of bread, they fed everybody and there were 12 baskets still left. Whatever happened to that movement? And there they were, scared, in fear, huddled in a small room like this in the context of a larger community that feels threatening. And Jesus appeared, and what did he say? Peace. Peace. And he also said, peace I give you, right? And he what? Blew in and filled the community with the Spirit of God. And he said, do not be afraid. There's a great spiritual awakening that is happening here. The outpouring of the Spirit of God is here in this place, but it is also taking place. It is, in other words, long before we even realized, long before we had dreams, long before we saw visions, God put in motion already what is going to happen in this community. It takes act of faith to accept and receive that. Long before God put in motion in this place, in this community, already. That's, you know, sometimes I wonder and ponder, like, how did I end up in Plano? How did you end up here? It is not by accident that we are here together as a community. God placed in motion. If you believe that this is a random accident, there's no place for faith here then. There's a God's design and vision and prophecy and dreams that is taking place here for us to respond to our larger community. Pentecost is happening now. We wave our flag. This is not a symbolic gesture. It is actually in motion. When our family came in 1974, immigrants here, already it was in motion. When you move to this community, already God placed in motion. When you are here today, listening to the scripture and worshiping community here today, God set in motion beyond our imagination and our knowing. I'm not saying God is predicting the future for us. What I am saying is that, like Peter, we are called to see vision. We are not drunk here. We look very silly doing this. Can you imagine people who have no connection with the church and look at us on this Memorial weekend? We should be vacationing somewhere. And here we are, taking our time, precious time, and waving our red little thingy. And people are looking, who are these people? What are they doing? They must be drunk. And we say, excuse me, it's only 10 in the morning today. Because you see, however silly we look, and the fashion of Roman Empire hasn't changed because this is the necktie that they wore, a stole back then, and I'm still wearing it. However silly we may look, in the eyes of the world, the Spirit of God is in this place, and God set in motion already. And the question is then, as the outpouring of the Spirit of God is happening, how are we as a church going to participate in this movement that God has already set in motion? Open our hearts. Like the early disciples who were in fear, who had no idea what the future may hold. Hear the words of Jesus. I know your past. I know we had huge gatherings, and those good old days, the best of our days, seems like it's gone. But God just started. Always. Do not be afraid. And I breathe into you. The same Spirit of God that was in the disciples and the early disciples who experienced the Pentecost is with us this day. And he continues to nudge us and lead us into the future. And all God's people said, Amen.
Let us stand and state what we believe using the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
At this time, let us share our joys and our concerns so that we may lift them up as an intercessory prayer. Any concerns? Oh, go ahead.
I have three joys.
Yeah.
One, my current three jobs that are all part-time working, which are all going away, but it's being replaced by a new job that's going to be coming real soon. Very happy about that. Starting 2 years ago, our movie from East to West Plano,
Thanks. Thank you for sharing good news. Things are opening up for you. Thank you. All right. Okay, yes, Barbara.
My joy is that we're all here today.
Thank you. All right.
So, I don't know if everybody heard of Gary Peterson.
Peterson, yeah.
Had a stroke in Iowa. I heard from Barb this morning that there's a pretty good improvement. There's still some work he's having a problem with. They should be headed home Wednesday in our planning on we have to start right away.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, he had a stroke a few days ago and now he's doing better. Yes. Go ahead. Prayer for Pat, who will have a heart surgery. Okay. Any others? Yes. Hello. Oh, that's a long drive. Okay. Safe travels. Thank you. Yes. Okay. For Denise Jones, recovery from surgery. Yes.
From the Zoom, this is from Karen. So Dottie Robin, who visited with her from her retirement community, passed away on Monday.
Okay. Prayer for Dottie Robin.
Dottie Robin, R-O-V-I-N.
Okay. For prayers for the family and friends who are grieving.
Correct.
Thank you. Any other joys or concerns? Yes. Prayer for refugee center, is that what it
yes.
is? Okay. All right. It's unfortunate all these places that we need are closing down. Yes. Any others? Okay. Let's take a deep breath. Let us pray. Merciful and gracious God, here we are, every year we come together on Pentecost Sunday to celebrate the birth of the church, your body, the birth of the body of Christ in our world. And you have called us from many different places, united by the same Spirit, to bear witness to the vision and the prophecy and dreams that you have given us. And we look around in our world, in our community, close friends and family members, and we see so much pain and suffering. So we come together to pray at this hour, to intercede on their behalf, that your Spirit may touch them, give them the strength they need today, especially those who are grieving because their loved one has passed away. We pray for Dottie Robin, who passed away, and we pray for family members and friends. Comfort them. Give them peace. We pray for Denise Jones, who is recovering. We pray for your healing presence. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for Pat, who will be having a heart surgery. Guide the hands of the surgeons and nurses. Be with them. Give her the strength that she needs. And we pray for Gary Peterson, who just had stroke recently. As he struggles with his mind and his body, we pray that you will give him the strength and healing presence that he needs this day. Be with Barbara as she travels a long distance. Safe travels, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those who are in need of refugee service. Unfortunately, that place has been closed down. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your compassion. We ask that others may step in and provide the kind of a service there that needs to be served in our community. Lord, in your mercy. On this day of Pentecost, as we remember the birth of the church and your inclusive spirit, we also recognize that inclusion is not just about diversity, but it's about justice. It's about peacemaking, that all voices that are marginalized may be heard, and that your presence may be felt in those places, and that you have called us to bear witness in places of conflict and violence that discriminates, that creates refugees and displacement of so many people in our world. As we remember this day of Pentecost, of the very movement of your spirit to touch lives, to bring people together, to share meals, to know that at the heart of all hearts that we are one human family created by one creator. Lord, in your mercy. Trusting that your spirit has touched each and every one of us as we move forward into the future. Lord, we confess that we are not perfect, but it is not about perfection, but that you have bought us as imperfect as we may be, that your spirit works in and through us. And we give you thanks, Lord, in your mercy. Trusting in your spirit, as we recognize that we have shared one baptism and one spirit, we pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from time to trial, and deliver us from evil. For your kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now let us turn to one another with the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. Gather at the Lord's table. This table is open to all, no matter where you are. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, eternal God. Your spirit hovered over the waters and brought forth all creation. You breathe into us the breath of life and set us on the earth to praise and serve you. When we lost our way, you called us back. Then sent your own son to save us. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Jesus, our Savior and Lord, by your Spirit you named him beloved and empowered him to serve the poor, proclaiming freedom from sin's bondage and befriend the friendless and the outcast. When he breathed his last upon a cross, you raised him from the tomb, breaking the power of death and opening the way to eternal life. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine from the gift you have given us, and celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Let us declare the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Unite us with Christ and with all who trust in him, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Set our hearts aflame with the love for the truth and the desire to do your will. Make our witness to Christ burn brightly, and keep us faithful until Christ comes in final victory. And we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus took bread and gave thanks to God, and he broke the bread, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." He took the cup, and he poured the wine. He gave thanks to God, and he turned to his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood shed for you. The feast of Christ, ready for us."
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, may we who have received this sacrament live in the unity of your Holy Spirit, that we may show forth your gifts to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
This afternoon after worship
is canceled so that we could have more fellowship this morning. Any other additional?
Yes. Since it's the birthday of the church, we have gifts for each household to celebrate, to extend your celebration to your domestic church at home. So meet me in the narthex, and I'll hand you a birthday celebration back.
People of God, we remember the story of the Pentecost. It is not something of the past. We are here today, 2023, and the Pentecost is happening here and now. Spirit's great awakening is in motion. Doesn't matter how old or how young you are. We see visions, we see prophecy, and we dream dreams. The Spirit of God is working and through us today. Every Pentecost, we are reborn. A birthday is not of the past, but we are born again this day. So may the Spirit of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the communion of Holy Spirit, the love of God, be with each and every one of us as we birth, led by the Spirit, to bear witness to God's love. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Risen One.